ओके, गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी. वेलकम टू द 18th लेक्चर ऑफ IPA50 वेबिनार सीरीज न्यू होराइजन्स इन फिजिक्स. एज यू नो, दिस इज द सीरीज विच इज कोमेमोरेटिंग 50 इयर्स ऑफ इंडियन फिजिक्स एसोसिएशन IPA, विच हैज प्लेड द रोल इन ब्रिंगिंग अबाउट फिजिक्स कम्युनिटी इन द कंट्री विद रिसर्चर्स, टीचर्स एंड यंग स्टूडेंट्स. So we bring you a variety of lectures of different facets of physics, and today we have a very special lecture which brings out a synergy between the fundamental research and the applications. Today we have a very eminent physicist, Professor Lahiri, who works in radiochemistry and will talk about nuclear medicine applications. To introduce him and conduct today's lecture, we have Dr. Professor Maumita Maiti from Physics Department of IIT Roorkee. She also is working in the applications of nuclear physics in a wide variety of fields, from medicine to agriculture and trace elements and the synthesis of ion sources for new generation of radioactive ion beams. So without much further ado, I now invite Maumita to introduce today's speaker and conduct today's lecture. Over to you, Maumita.
Thank you, Professor Nanal, for giving me the opportunity to coordinate today's IPA lecture. Without wasting time, let me introduce Professor Lahiri, today's speaker. Professor Sushanta Lahiri, a senior professor of the Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics, is now head of the Chemical Sciences Division. His major research interests are accelerator production of neutron-deficient radionuclides, radiotracer technique, green chemistry, trace analysis, naturally occurring radioactive materials, super-heavy element research, accelerator mass spectrometry, etc. In connection to the academics, he has an excellent link to many national and international universities and institutes. He has enjoyed the academic environment of CERN, RIKEN, ETH Zurich, and TU Delft as a visiting scientist. He is the recipient of the Hevesi Medal Award of 2015, which is the highest international honor in the field of nuclear and radiochemistry. Hevesi Medal Award was instituted in 1968 after the demise of Nobel laureate George Charles de Hevesi. Professor Lahiri is the first Indian to receive the award. He also received Professor J.C. Ghose's medal bestowed by Indian Chemical Society for excellence in chemistry. He was selected two times as an associate member of Third World Academy of Sciences. DSc degree was conferred on him by the University of Calcutta in 2009. He is working as an editorial board member for JRNC, Radiochemical ACTA. He is a member of international bodies like CERN Medicis, International Board of Biomonitoring, etc. As a principal investigator, he has completed many national and international projects, including 11th and 12th five-year plan project of DAE. He has 250 publications in international peer-reviewed journal in his credit, more than 300 conference or symposia report, 10 book chapters. He has supervised 13 PhDs. With this brief introduction, we invite Professor Lahiri to deliver his talk. Over to you, Professor Lahiri.
Thank you, Maumita. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. So thank you, Maumita, for this elaborate introduction. Thanks also to Professor Bandana Nanal for mainly for two reasons. For inviting me, first of all, for inviting me to this lecture, IPA lecture. And secondly, as you know, that I am also working in TIFR accelerator. I started my work in the TIFR accelerator in 1999. And from 1999 to 2019, except this year due to the corona reason, I came every year more than one time, two, three, four times. I had beam time in TIFR Pelotron. And in this long 20 years journey, whenever I needed something, because I am coming from Calcutta, from Shaha Institute to do work in the TIFR Peloton, everything was not with me. So whenever I need anything, maybe in the midnight, I need an amplifier or a power supply, even the detector. So I have to rush to Professor Manal's laboratory. Professor Vandana, I asked her, and every time I got immense cooperation for last 20 years. So this is the second reason I am thankful to you. So this lecture is not for the expert. Actually, I was told that many postgraduate students, young researchers may be there. So it's a general introduction, mainly the historical introduction. The topic is trains in accelerator research, super heavy elements to isotopes for nuclear medicine. When I had a second thought, then I thought that this is impossible to cover the entire spectrum of accelerator research from super heavy to isotope for nuclear medicine. If you just see any one of the TIFR beam cycle, then you will see people are working from nuclear physics, nuclear chemistry, nuclear medicine, space research, atomic physics, condensed matter physics, all of them. So I am even not competent enough to give the entire spectrum. So what I did, I just changed this word to and made super heavy elements and isotopes for nuclear medicine. So I will discuss these two topics. Before going to the main lecture, I would like to introduce what is in brief. What is super heavy element and what are the isotopes for nuclear medicine? So if you go through the periodic table, before super heavy element, I have to say about heavy element. So this actinide series, thorium actinide to lawrencium, this is called the actinide elements or heavy elements. And after lawrencium, rutherfordium to ognatium, 104 to 118 element, this is called transactinide or super heavy elements. Second, the isotopes for nuclear medicine. This is the radionuclide chart. Perhaps in this lecture series, you have seen this many times. So the first question is, we have now about 3000 radionuclides and it is expandable. So whether all these radionuclides can be used in nuclear medicine? The answer is of course no. We have certain criteria, moderate radiological and biological half-life, simple decay scheme, rapid clearance from the body, type and energy of the particle emission. So these are some criteria by which a radionuclide qualify for nuclear medicine. The question is, we have passed 75 years of the Hiroshima, 34 years of the Chernobyl, Fukushima is in our memory. Still, why we need to inject radioactivity in our fellow human body? The answer is, we will get some information that we cannot get otherwise. That's why we need to inject. Even 75 years after the Hiroshima, we need to inject small amount of radioactivity to the human body. So with this brief introduction of the super heavy, and I would say definition of the super heavy and nuclear medicine, I would like to go to my topic. Now, the question is, the super heavy elements and isotope of nuclear medicine, their rationale is different. One is the application oriented, application to the human body, and one is a basic research. How these two topics, they come together? So, to say that, to justify these two topics, how these two topics come together, I have to introduce you some of the iconic figures. All of them are Nobel laureate. First, E.O. Lawrence, who in 1929, at his 28 years of age, discovered the first cyclotron. And for this, in 1939, he received the Nobel Prize. Second, in 1935, the Nobel Prize in Chemistry was awarded jointly to Frederick Joliot and Irene Joliot-Curie in recognition of the synthesis of the new radioactive elements. And from 1935 onwards, after Frederick Joliot and Irene Joliot synthesized artificially new radioactive isotopes. These elements were known, but they have prepared new isotopes synthetically. From that, nuclear science is working on new elements, new radioactive isotopes. They work for life. They work for treatment of diagnosis of cancer and deadly diseases. In the meantime, I just take a break and I go to the periodic table, Mendeleev's periodic table, published in 1872. The periodic table, Mendeleev's periodic table, is unique in the sense Mendeleev put many dashes in their periodic table, predicting that there will be some elements which will be discovered later on. In 1935 or so, for the scientists, this periodic table became Bible. Whatever element predicted in the periodic table, they know that should be discovered. So after the discovery of the artificial element in 1935, the periodic table looks like few positions are still vacant. In the main periodic table, element number 43, 87, 85, 61. And scientists guess there will be five more elements after the uranium, the known heaviest element. Why five elements? They guessed at that time, because in the Mendeleev's periodic table, after uranium, there are five dashes. So at least these five elements should be discovered. I'll take another gentleman, Professor Emilio Segri. In 1937, he discovered the first artificial element, technetium. He was Italian physicist working in the Berkeley cyclotron, the cyclotron discovered by Lorentz, and requested Lorentz to give some thrown away pieces from the cyclotron. Lorentz gave molybdenum. This time, this is not possible. This molybdenum came from a Berkeley to Italy, Palermo. Emilio Segri was an excellent chemist and excellent physicist. Earlier, he discovered slow neutron with Fermi. Now, he separated, and that is very difficult because there was no hint. He separated some new isotopes, some atoms of the new isotope, new element, from the molybdenum, probably produced by molybdenum D2N reaction, because this molybdenum was bombarded with deuteron in the Berkeley laboratory, 95 technetium, 97 technetium. And afterwards, because of the World War, he went back to Berkeley laboratory, and with Glenn Tissebaugh in the reactor, he discovered 99 technetium. So the 99M technetium and other technetium isotope discovery was rather silent. In 1940, Emilio Segri again discovered another isotope, astatine. Both technetium and astatine, there were no stable counterpart in the periodic table, no stable element is available. Both the elements are artificially produced. Of course, there are some amount of astatine available in the uranium decay series. The longest lived isotope of astatine is 8.3 hours. And astatine 211 isotope is called the isotope of, for the alpha therapy. Because 99, these radio isotopes which are used in nuclear medicine can be used for diagnosis. 99 M technetium is the excellent diagnostic radioisotope. Even today, more than 10 million of patients are diagnosed every year by 99 M technetium. And 211 astatin A alpha emitter is called the radioisotope for targeted therapy. In this point, I would make a comment from the Alfred Nobel will, where he wrote the Nobel Prize would be given to those who have conferred to the greatest benefit to humankind. So the discovery of 99M technetium and 211 astatine must be the greatest benefit to the humankind. Unfortunately, Segre has not received Nobel Prize for this discovery, but he was a colorful physicist or chemist, and then he discovered antiproton, and for discovery of antiproton, he got Nobel Prize in 1959. The next person I would like to introduce you, Enrico Fermi, is a celebrated physicist of the 20th century. That time the periodic table again was like this shape. Technetium has already discovered by Segre. And Enrico Fermi, he gave HP, now it is named Neptunium. He discovered one element, first element after the uranium, which has been produced in his word, by the reaction of the uranium plus neutron. So this is the first element, and for this he was awarded Nobel Prize for discovering first transuranium element. So Nobel Prize was given for his demonstration of the existence of the new radioactive elements. But this was the greatest blunder of the Nobel Committee in physics. Enrico Fermi can be given Nobel Prize for 100 of reasons, but why this is a blunder? In 1938, Otto Hahn, Lise Meitner, and Fritz Strassmann, they recognized that Enrico Fermi actually splitted the uranium atom to a smaller, lighter elements, not produced the heavier elements. Otto Hahn, Meitner, and Fritz Strassmann discovered fission. So therefore, Fermi neither discovered element 93 nor the fission. So this is the periodic table at that time in 1940, Edwin Macmillan, again from Berkeley Laboratory. Except Frederick Curie and Irene Curie, everybody is from Berkeley Laboratory. Edwin Macmillan, by the same reaction, but this time, he produced 239 uranium, which is beta decay. By beta decay, produced 239 neptunium. Again, he discovered neptunium. And chemistry played a very important role because the properties of the neptunium and uranium are different. He could separate this neptunium and uranium. And for this, Edwin Macmillan again received the Nobel Prize. So this is at least one element you know in the periodic table for discovery of one element. Two Nobel Prizes were given, one to Fermi and again to Macmillan. So this is the first transuranium element actually discovered. And then this is the history, plutonium, americium, curium was discovered, plutonium and americium were discovered 1940 and 45. Plutonium and helium, by the reaction of plutonium and alpha particle, curium was discovered in 1944. In 49, berkelium was discovered. 1950, californium was discovered. And the one person is responsible is the Glenn T. Seaborg. And you remember, the Glenn T. Seaborg was also responsible for discovering 99M technetium, the magical isotope for nuclear medicine. The next history is very interesting. In 1952, this is the picture of Ivy Mike. The hydrogen bomb was tested in Pacific Ocean, first hydrogen bomb. And from the debris of the hydrogen bomb, this And two elements, einsteinium and fermium, were identified and isolated from the Berkeley laboratory again. And after that, Berkeley laboratory discovered Mendelevium, Nobelium, and Lawrencium. In 1961, Lawrencium was discovered. This time, from alpha particle, they have shifted to heavy ion carbon and boron as a projectile. So this is the periodic table at that time in 1961. All the elements has been discovered, and all the elements were discovered in Berkeley laboratory. Glenn T. Seaborg was responsible, and for that, he received the Nobel Prize. So this is almost, we are going to 1921. So it is 60 years before present from 1961. The last element, Lawrencium, was discovered, the last element of the actinide series. So the, of course, the question is, what is next? In 1964, 67 and 74, again three elements, 104, 105 and 106, were synthesized in Berkeley laboratory. So questions, we have synthesized some combination of proton and neutron, which you can call the element 104 or 105 or 106, but what will be the chemical behavior of these elements? Can we place them in the periodic table? If yes, where will we place? So the search for room in the periodic table for the newly discovered elements started. And a new scientific discipline born, which is called atom at a time chemistry or super heavy element chemistry. So the question is, okay, can we place 104 here or 105 here? So to answer this question, we need the chemical properties of 104 and 105 elements. So that if we put 105 here, so this means the properties of 105 will be similar to its homologue, vanadium, niobium, tantalum. And to do that, we have to do chemistry. With proto complex formation, TBP and trioctyl phosphinoxide formation, nitrate complex formation, fluoro complex formation, sulfate complex formation, and so on. A lots of chemistry experiments were going in mainly in the Riken in Japan. They did the anion exchange chemistry with hydrofluoric acid and nitric acid. So the extraction behavior, plotted zirconium and hafnium and the rutherfordium, and in a similar condition, they had seen the rutherfordium have the same slope with the zirconium and hafnium when the concentration of nitric acid is plotted against the distribution. The experiment was repeated 4,000 cycles. 4,000 cycles, just imagine. The same has been done for niobium, tantalum, and element 105. Thousands of this experiment was repeated 1,700 times. And remember, the half-lives of these isotopes are very small. The number of isotopes, they are only numbered. Few isotopes are available at a time. So it is a very difficult, painful experiment. And ultimately, with these experiments, with the chemistry experiments only, in 1974, it was decisively confirmed that this element, which we call now super heavy element, other 104, 105, and 106, can be placed in the periodic table here after hafnium, tantalum, and tungsten. All them were B for the Berkeley, so all they were Berkeley product, these elements. This 106 was named after Glenn T. Seaborg. That time he was alive. This is a very famous picture. Seaborg was pointing the element named in his name. And after that, after the discovery of element 106, it was shifted to Darmstadt. The Darmstadt era, Darmstadt in a small village in Germany, where we have a cyclotron, GSI. This is the picture of the GSI. I spent a lot of nights here also for some of our experiment in super heavy elements. So in 1981, element 107, 82, element 109, 84, element 108, and 94, element 110 was discovered. But you know, you see, this time the projectiles are chromium, quite heavy projectiles, iron and nickel. So they were discovered by cold fusion. What is cold fusion? So by definition, nuclear excitation energy is low. Stable target. Here all the targets, bismuth, 209 bismuth is a stable target. 208 lead is a stable target. So with the help of the stable target, this by cold fusion, these elements were produced. These are some other examples of cold fusion. And what is hot fusion? If I say cold fusion, I have to say about what is hot fusion. Hot fusion is 4 to 5. Neutrons are emitted. Nuclear excitation energy 30 to 50 MeV. And radioactive target. For example, curium, when bombarded with oxygen, target is curium. Curium is radioactive target. Berkelium is radioactive target. 5 and 5 curium when bombarded with oxygen, other fodium is produced. This is hot fusion. This is very difficult to produce these super heavy elements. This is not as simple as doing some reactions, because the cross section, the probability of nuclear reaction is very, very, very low. And I have a table. For example, rutherfordium can be produced 4 atom per minute. Dubnium can be produced half an atom, just imagine half an atom per minute. Whereas element 1012, just 1 atom per week can be produced. And the cross section comes from nanobond to picobond level. So for this, very high-end accelerators are required. So the super heavy experiment is really challenged. It should be a unique combination of physical separator, detection system, data acquisition system, high current, high energy, high current heavy ion accelerators, and targetry. Targetry is a very crucial step. How much it's difficult? Just we'll go to the element 1013, which was discovered in Riken. In July 2004, the first event, first atom of element 113 was discovered in Riken. To confirm, they have to wait till the next year, about 9 months. In April 2, 2005, the second event was discovered. And the third event was discovered 7 years after, in 2012. By Morita and his crew. So this is the history of the super heavy element. And in the meantime, this, just 1 minute, I just come my voice. Sorry. So I must say about the TASCA, transactinide separator and chemistry apparatus, which was built in GSI. So without saying about TASCA, the story of the super heavy element is incomplete. In 2005, it was built. It was commissioned in 2006 to 2008, and in 2009, Z equal to 114 was produced by TASCA. So TASCA commissioning completed. This is a small report of the GSI. And I'm proud to say the Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics is one of the participants in the TASCA commissioning report that published in 2008. It was said that TASCA is a most versatile and highest efficient instrument for super heavy element research. And it has entered in the region of the transactinides, which is called the terra incognita. In TASCA till now, element 112, 114, 115, 117, 119, and 120 experiment was done. So element 11, we joined, Shaha Institute joined when the experiment of element 112 is going in TASCA. Uranium plus calcium beam, the element 112 was produced. What is the chemistry of the element 112 that was the that was searched by the TASCA group. Then element 114, the timeline of the experiment was 2 months, May, June. And in May, June, we have seven elements, the seven incidents of the 114. We have found 13 chains total in seven. And this came, of course, in the physical review letter, and the discovery of the new isotope 277 Hb. In Dubna, it was done in 2004, and it was repeated in 2012 in TASCA. And our cross-section is better than the Dubna cross-section. Then the campaign for element 1017 started. 48 calcium plus 249 berkelium. In the campaign, this is the element 117 collaboration. Shaha Institute is there. In the element 117 collaboration, berkelium was produced in USA. And in Oak Ridge National Laboratory, from Oak Ridge National Laboratory, this berkelium came to GSI in the University of Mines. They made the target. Target is a very special type of target. And ultimately, we have detected 7 alpha chains. Our group leader, Christoph Duellmann, said that if you have to detect a super heavy element, if you have to confirm the super heavy element, you have to confirm all, first of all, you have to confirm all the alpha chain to a known one. Second, you have to confirm all the alpha chains to a known one. And third, you have to confirm all the alpha chains from the known one. So ultimately, you have to confirm, this is we call the 117 element, and we have a alpha chain, and we got 266 lawrencium and by this. So Dubna has done this 1 year before, but the interesting thing is that the few alpha-like events was missing in Dubna's experiment. So that way, this is the first confirmation of the independent confirmation. Dubna has discovered element 117 before the TASCA group, but TASCA group independently confirmed element 117. And the most interesting in this, our alpha chain, there are isotopes, 1.3 hour and 1.6 hour new isotopes, which has a quite big half-life in terms of the super heavy elements. Because in this super heavy elements, you have the half-lives, millisecond, second order half-life, where our order half-life is really something to go to the stability line, something stability line. So we have discovered 270 dubnium, a new isotope, and 266 lawrencium. This paper came, of course, in physical review later. So international working team included 72 scientists, including India. They independently confirmed element 117. And as I told, that half-life about 1 hour actually gave so much response to the scientists. So whether really we are heading toward the island of the stability. This came in newspapers, many newspapers. And according to American Physical Society, this paper is the fifth best paper of 2014. This is the Tasker team who discovered 117. Now the element 1108 was discovered by Euro in Dubna, and it is named on the name of Dr. Yuri Oganesian. So Oganesian is the 118th element and only the living element in today's periodic table. But after 118, which way is the island? Tasker was in search of that. Tasker did experiment to discover element 119 and 120. We were there in this collaboration. This is a report from the science. Before the experiment is so interesting. Before the experiment, some report came into the science. And titanium plus californium, by the reaction of titanium and californium, we want to discover element 120 and titanium plus berkelium 119. But we were not successful. Earlier, Dubna did up to 40 femtobarn cross section, GSI up to 20 femtobarn cross section, and Tasker again up to 40 femtobarn cross section. But no one obtained any chain, but maybe in the future. So the future of the super heavy element, not only discovering of 119 and 128 elements, but many questions. What is the volatility that has to be addressed? Copernicium, what is the reactivity? Whether they have the metal organic compounds, lots of work is going on in this direction, in the RICAIN and in GSI collaboration. They came in Nature and Science. Fully relativistic quantum theory. What is the complexation property, redox property? What is the radius of Mendeleev, ionic radius, nobelium, lawrencium, and these elements? The story is not yet end. There is a question of the lawrencium. The first time ionic radius of the lawrencium was discovered, and it was like the alkali metal. So it is questioned whether lawrencium is really in the actinide series. Maybe in the future, IUPAC will change the position of the lawrencium in the group three elements, maybe possible. So this is ever ongoing process. So summary, till now, what I have told, see, the Berkeley Laboratory, they discovered technetium. Berkeley Laboratory discovered heavy elements. Berkeley Laboratory discovered super heavy elements. So the motivation of the was only the blank spaces in the Mendeleev's periodic table. It was a Bible. They thought these period blank spaces should have, one element should occupy this space. And this element may be an element for the nuclear medicine or maybe super heavy elements. So I completed the first part, accelerator research in super heavy elements. I would like to go to the second part, accelerator research, isotopes for the nuclear medicine. The goals of the nuclear medicine is to visualize the organs, localization of the tumors, detection of the abnormalities, determination of the metabolic pathway, and introduction of radiation sources into specific sites for therapy. As I told, the radioisotopes can be used for diagnosis and for therapy. Diagnosis, there may be SPECT, single photon emission computed tomography, technetium, gallium, thallium, iodine, etc. PET is now very popular. 18FDG is now very popular. There are more than 20 or 30 medical isotopes in India, which is producing 18F for imaging of the patient. But the first one was established in Tata Memorial Hospital, Radiation Medicine Center, DAE Radiation Medicine Center. Now there are many private also. And the radioisotope can be used in therapy also. There may be targeted alpha therapy, astatine Bismuth, 225 actinium. Targeted beta therapy, beta particles range is 5 to 150 cell diameter, and even the Auger electron therapy. Out of these all isotopes, these all are accelerator produced, except 99M technetium, which is a reactor produced isotope. So the nuclear medicine has passed a series of growth phases. If you understand this have to understand. The first growth phase is a foundation in therapy. After the discovery of radium by Madame Curie, radium was immediately used for therapy. The second growth phase is evolvement as diagnostic tool, mainly after the discovery of radiotracer technique by George de Hevesy, the radioisotopes became a diagnostic tool. The third growth phase, again in recognition in therapy and diagnosis. This is after the discovery of the accelerators and the reactors. 99, artificial radioisotope. Present growth phase is progress is theranostic, means therapy plus diagnostic. We can have some isotopes which will act for both therapy and diagnostic. So theranostic is the present and current thrust of the nuclear medicine. Theranostic refer to pairing of therapeutic and diagnostic radioactive candidate related to same compound and targeted towards particular clinical condition. So some theranostic pairs are 43 scandium, 47 scandium, 64 copper, 67 copper, this will be copper, 83 strontium, 89 strontium, 86 yttrium, 90 yttrium, 124 iodine, 131 iodine, 203 lead, 212 lead. So all of these pairs have combination of beta plus and beta minus. So by beta minus, you can go for therapy. For beta plus, you can go positron emission tomography. But nowadays, theranostic radionuclides got sudden momentum after the exhaustive research, mainly in and around Geneva. Because in the meantime, the attention of peer became focused on four radioisotopes, 149, 152, 155, and 161 terbium. This is called the promising quadruplet in nuclear medicine. 149 terbium has a 4 hours half-life. It has alpha decay mode, 4 MeV alpha particle. So 4 MeV alpha particle, 4 hours half-life, in excellent for the therapeutic purpose. 152 terbium, 17 hours half-life, positron emitter, so it can be a PET or even SPET because it has a good gamma. 155 terbium, T-half is 5.3 days, electron capture, it can be used in PET and SPET. And 161 terbium, its decay mode is beta minus 100%. Also, it emits Auger electrons. So high multiplicity and high ability of Auger electrons is effective in reducing in survival capacity of the cancerous cell cultures. So this can be a diagnostic therapeutic isotope. So the terbium is called the Swiss knife because it can be used in alpha therapy, it can be used in space electron or electron therapy. Problem is how to produce the terbium radioisotope. It has been proved that generally, the accelerator produced isotopes are produced in the normal accelerators of maximum 30 MeV energy. But these terbium isotopes, they cannot be produced in a good amount because you have to play. In super heavy elements, we have only few atoms in hand, but here we have to play. You have at least some mega becquerel activity. Otherwise, it would not work. So the amount required for the therapeutic dose or the diagnostic dose to produce these normal cyclotrons are not sufficient. It cannot be produced by proton activation or alpha activation. Heavy ion? No, it cannot be produced by heavy ion activation. So the only thing left is the proton-induced spallation reaction on heavy targets like tantalum and tungsten, very high energy. So this spallation protons is not available in the common cyclotrons. Only a few cyclotron, few accelerators can provide this spallation protons. And I come to the CERN. CERN is the known for the best known for the Higgs boson, God's particle, high energy physics. But do you know the CERN also came into the medical isotope business? CERN to start, this is the CERN bulletin, page from the CERN bulletin in 2012, and they declared that we have to produce the medical isotopes. And for this, CERN started a facility called CERN Medicis, which is a unique facility worldwide. Medical isotopes, Medicis means medical isotopes collected from Isoldi, CERN Isoldi. This is the Medicis building. There are some external partners. I am also in the external partner of this CERN Medicis program. The CERN in 2018, this project was started in 2012, and only in 2018, CERN announced that they finally produced some 155 terbium, which is a part of the 149, 152, 155, 161 terbium family. And then onwards, they are regularly producing terbium isotopes by 1.4 giga electron volt proton-induced spallation reaction on tantalum rhenium targets. And what CERN Medicis true, they told this is a translational research isotope production to the patient. All these steps will be done, can be done with the help of CERN Medicis. For example, PSI, they separated 149 terbium and 152 terbium, 150 to 49 terbium alpha meter. They collected from the CERN Medicis program. Then they did chemical separation. Then they did with the some radiopharmaceutical, attached with the radiopharmaceutical, and targeted alpha therapy was done with the rat models. And 152 terbium, the prostate cancer, this was used for the PET scanning. And from the patient's CT image, PET image, where 152 terbium was taken. So 149 terbium, 152 terbium, they are produced in spallation reaction, and CERN is sending regularly to the hospitals in and around Geneva for introducing to the human body and to the biological trials. 161 terbium they have also produced, and preclinical therapy is already done at PSI. And this is also a beta emitter and a very good therapeutic radionuclide. So with the Bombay scene, with the biology, highest level of biology, they have checked the efficacy of 161 terbium. So CERN is not stopped only by powerful terbium quadruplet. They are also interested other alpha emitting radioisotope. From the Isoldi, they have separated 203 bismuth, and 100 years after the discovery of Madame Curie of radium, again 224 radium isotope is discovered, and it is pear-shaped. That shook the world, it came in the Nature. But we are not bothered about the pear shape, we are bothering about the half-life of the 224 radium. It is 3.6 days. It's an alpha emitter. It has a 5.678 MeV alpha energy. So this is a very good radionuclide for alpha therapy. So it started from Madame Curie, 226 radium. It is not in today's term, it is not suitable because it has a 1600 year half-life. Though alpha energy was 5 MeV, fantastic, but only because of half-life, it is not suitable. But from Madame Curie, now we have the 211 astatine as an alpha emitting radioisotope for alpha therapy. 149 terbium, mainly produced in CERN, and 224 radium, also produced in CERN. They have an excellent half-life for alpha therapy. So this is the current state of the research. And even beyond, we have to go. For example, I'll just give one example. These are my old slide, and all I told this, all these are accelerator produced except this 99M technetium. But even that one isotope, millions of patients are treated with, more than 90% diagnosis is carried out by this isotope. And there is a blackout. There is a reactor failure, shortage of this isotope. And this came in the Nature. So 99M technetium supply shortage. So where will go? Where will go? What is next? If we don't have reactor, because there are public sentiment against reactor. They say no to reactor. So if the reactor is not there, we will not have 99M technetium. Where we have to go? What is next? In 2010, in the CERN ISOLD user meeting, we proposed that multi-megawatt converter targets may be one of the potential solutions for production of the clinically important radionuclides. What is multi-million converter target? So it is actually a high Z targets. 1.4 GeV proton beam is coming from one side, and by various types of nuclear reaction inside, neutrons are coming. So protons are converted basically as if protons are converted to the neutrons. So this is called multi-megawatt target. So this is for the radioactive ion beam purpose from the basic research, but we told it's okay. The basic research is okay, but by the energy, by the interaction of high energy protons, there must be many radionuclides. And we wanted to make the total inventory. One was done in 2014, and another was done in 2016. First time we have irradiated one lead bismuth eutectic target, which is converted target, with 1.4 GeV proton, with a small amount of beam, proton beam, high energy beam, and we found lots of radionuclides with very high activity there. So our assumption is correct that, okay, this converter target may act as a future source of the radionuclide. Also, very interestingly, we confirmed on the LBE target astatine. How astatine will come? Because bismuth was irradiated with proton. It will come polonium. So only bismuth proton pion induced reaction can produce astatine. And we found astatine. So astatine was confirmed. This is the one alpha emitter radionuclide for targeted alpha therapy. So this is can be confirmed in the LBE target. So I finished. I don't want to give a conclusion, but only I want to quote from Lawrence, because whatever basic research you do nowadays, if you have to get money for the basic research, what Lawrence told to Niels Bohr, if you have to continue the basic research, probably for that only started the CERN Medicis project, you have to do biological work, you have to do something very important for the direct application to the humankind, and with the help of that, you can sustain with your basic research. So I'm finished. I thank you. Thanks to the organizing committee, Dr. Yusuf, Dr. Nanal, Dr. Raoud, my PhD students, my postdoctoral associates, my all co-authors, to you, today's audience. And after this question answering session, I'll still be there. You can also write if you have any question to me by my email address or ask for my research guide. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Lahiri, for a wonderful talk. Can we take a couple of questions from the audience? Okay. So there is a question from Yogesh Gupta. Yeah. Who ask you that fission barrier is either zero or very small for the super heavy elements. Mm-hmm. But still, most of the super heavies decay by alpha chains, mm-hmm. not spontaneous fission. Why?
You are the right person to answer this.
No, you are the speaker today.
I am not a physicist, so better you answer this question.
No, better you answer this question because you are a speaker today. So...
I will answer this question later on.
Okay, fine. From Abhinav Chaudhary, what is the best method to assess the absorbed dose to the target organs for nuclear medicine examinations?
There are various kinds of phantoms, mainly water phantoms, because the body has a 70% of the body is water. So generally in the water phantom, this dose is given, and from that the water dissociates to H dot and OH dot, and these free radicals are measured basically by the various reactions, chemical reactions.
Okay. A short comment from Pankaj Bagel. For the benefit of student, it would be nice to say a few words about how new generation of student can join these discoveries while doing PhD at Indian labs. Can you comment on this?
Nowadays, for example, the CERN has a Marie Curie program. And Marie Curie is a PhD for the PhD students, for the master students. And now if we, our authority, send the students for their master's degree for a Samad project or like that to these high-end laboratories, then our students will be benefited. And there are lots of programs like this. And lots of Indian institutes also are participating.
Okay, so we go to the next question from Devinder Siwal. How long it takes to the medical community to access the terbium target?
161 terbium has already applied to a patient in prostate cancer, but the other terbium isotopes are in the clinical stage. Maybe some 2-3 years, according to the medical rules and etc. All these trials.
Okay. Can you comment on the Indian scenario? In which way we are going towards the application of medical radionuclide?
This is very important and very good question. I want to comment on that. First of all, the Indian scenario in nuclear medicine worldwide, it is excellent. I have not mentioned one isotope, lutetium. The lutetium is also a very important radionuclide for therapy as well as for imaging purpose. And this lutetium is now regularly produced in Mumbai, in BRC, in the research reactors, and given to the many hospitals regularly supplying. As I told that 18 FDG was in 10 years before it was, nobody was knowing, but DAE first started this first medical cyclotron. And the last medical cyclotron is also in Calcutta. This Calcutta medical cyclotron, it is also DAE cyclotron. It has already started operation. They are producing gallium in a quantity, and they are supplying it to the nearby hospitals regularly. I know my colleague, Dr. Shankar, he goes every day at morning 6 o'clock, he is at the plant. He starts from home at 3 o'clock and goes morning 6 o'clock to distribute these isotopes to the Calcutta hospital, various hospitals and nursing homes in Calcutta. Patients are regularly treated. So the Indian scenario of using the radioisotopes is an excellent and promising, and the people who are involved there are doing a really something great. I would say great.
Okay, there is a message from Dr. Kailas to you. So he writes that Professor Lahiri used to spend almost 24 hours in the Pellatron lab during experiment. Hats off to his dedication.
Thank you, Dr. Kailas. And I was just talking to some of my colleagues that my in my younger days, I got what I would say, lots of indulgence from the stalwarts like you, because you were sometime on the chairman of the beam allotment committee, and you gave me a lot of beam time, and for that only we could do the experiment. So we remember all this.
Okay, we go to next question from P. Singh. Which are the labs working at present on Z is equal to 120 element?
GSI, at present GSI is not working. At present probably no one working. GSI has a plan, or MIMES has a plan, after the CW accelerator, if they can have a CW accelerator with very high current, the current will be even better than this one, much better than this one, then they will go for the 120 elements. Probably, I don't know, because until the experiment goes into a certain extent, people, they don't want to disclose. So, but GSI, I know they are not working.
Okay, we take the next question from Avinav Chaudhary. Does the PET scanner software corrects for the position branching ratio? Positron branching ratio of non-conventional nuclides such as 64 copper and 89 zirconium to calculate SUV values?
Must be, because I don't know, because I am not a medical physicist, but this medical physicist has in a very advanced stage, and they have lots of physicists, chemists, and maybe by the Fluca. Fluca is one of the important software to calculate all these things. And Fluca has been discovered in the CERN and Belgium, and all these people are working. Maybe, I don't know. I should say must be. Yeah.
Okay, I think with this, we have taken already many questions. I think with this, we from the IPA community, we thank Professor Lagiri for his wonderful talk.
Momita, can you take
the over to you. Yeah.
No, sorry. There is one last question from Yogesh Gupta, if that's possible.
Okay. Probably I missed then.
Yeah.
Okay, ma'am. Yes, sure. Do we know most of the chemical properties of the super heavies till Z is equal to 118?
Some of the properties we know, and some of the properties we are working on. For example, I told the Lorentzian, the Rajuddho Lorentzian is not the super heavy, the last element of the element. The ionic radius is known. 106 ionic radius is known. This is this experiment was done in Riken in collaboration with CERN and GSI. CERN joined first time the CERN ISOL-D because they made this ion source. So some of the properties are known, and lots of the properties are unknown. And that is the challenge.
Okay, I think no more question. Professor Nanal, I hope we took all the questions.
Yes. Anyone in Zoom may want to ask, you can just see, and otherwise we can wind up.
Yeah. Anyway, it's over to you, Professor Nanal, now.
Okay. Thank you, Momita. Just in case someone in Zoom has a question also, can just unmute themselves and ask the question.
Should I close this PowerPoint?
Yeah, you can. Okay, I don't see any hands. So I first want to thank Professor Lahiri for really a wonderful talk, because he made the connections between so many different facets of the science, I would say, because the chemistry and physics, and really bringing it into the application. And I think just want to add that even the discovery of fission, the chemistry played a big role in that. So it's natural that for all this super heavy elements, it is playing a role. And it's really wonderful that we have somebody from India taking such a big role in this field. And we were really fortunate to have it all from horse's mouth. And the responses from the audience in the YouTube say it all. Most of the people have actually put in very congratulatory messages. Thank you, Professor Momita, for conducting the lecture wonderfully and facilitating it. So, and I thank all the viewers to join in spite of a long weekend. It just really shows their commitment to the IPS series, and I really welcome that and appreciate that. So this was the last lecture of the 2020, and we all hope that 2021 will be a better year for everybody in all the respects.
We hope so.
So yes, wishing you all a very healthy and safe new year. Happy new year. And please join us next Saturday. We will have the lecture by Professor Sushil Mazumdar, who's recently been awarded IPA PKI Iyengar Memorial Award 2020. And he will be talking about optical Anderson localization in two-dimensional disordered systems. So in the meantime, stay safe, take care, enjoy yourself
for the new year.
And please do join us next week. Thank you all.
Okay, thank you. Bye. Thank you, Professor Larry, for a very nice talk. Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you.